Welcome to the Veritas Forum, engaging university students and faculty in discussions about life's hardest questions and the relevance of Jesus Christ to all of life.
We have two folks who are very well qualified to talk to us about suffering and evil in the world and the connection of those things to God. And at this time, I'm going to let each of them give a brief introduction, right? As you'll find through our conversation tonight, our conversation partners come from different perspectives. And so I'm going to ask them to briefly describe where they're coming from and how they think about the world, and in particular, how they think about the problem of evil. So Dr. Myers, I'll let you go first. Just to be clear, we're just introducing ourselves now. We'll get to specific questions in a second.
Okay, that's clear. Welcome, everyone, and thank you. Yes, I'm a philosopher of religion, as is Professor Ray, and I teach at Washington State. I've been there 23 years. I regularly teach the philosophy of religion course, and in that course, we have a unit on the problem of evil. The problem of evil is stated in philosophical terms that if there is a God who is all good, all powerful, and all knowing, then why is there evil in the world? So the topic tonight, suffering, making sense of suffering, that is a kind of a subsection, I guess you would say, of the philosophical problem of evil. So these are the things that we'll be looking at in the next few minutes. Now, I represent myself usually as what's called a religious pluralist, and I wanted to define religious pluralism by way of my introduction. So, religious pluralism is not a dogmatic metaphysics holding a closed set of claims about the universe. Rather, it is a special practical response to the fact of religious diversity. A religious pluralist inquires into the creative insights given in all the world's religious traditions while rejecting any claims that are inconsistent with human life and flourishing. So in other words, a religious pluralist tries to be open to the world's religious traditions and accept what is good in them, but at the same time keeping a critical view and rejecting those claims of any particular religion that would, as I said, go against human life or flourishing. So religious pluralism really is not a category in competition with any particular religion. One could be, for example, a Christian pluralist, a Jewish pluralist, or an atheist pluralist. In regard to the question of suffering and how a pluralist would look at that, I think all of the world's religious traditions, at least that I am familiar with, have examined the topic of suffering. While the theistic traditions of Hinduism and the religions of the book, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, have wrestled with great theodicies or solutions to the problem of evil, the non-theistic religions like Buddhism and Jainism and others have also made the end of suffering a central concern. For example, in Buddhism, there are the Four Noble Truths, which the Buddha taught very early on, and each of those addresses some different aspect of suffering. So suffering is a worldwide phenomenon. As our introducer said, it's really a matter of life, not just an intellectual matter, and all the religious traditions of the world have, I think, something to offer in terms of addressing the question of suffering. And it would be a good thing for us to inquire into what they have to say.
Thank you. And then Dr. Ray, I'd like to ask you also to introduce yourself a little bit. Tell us what kind of perspective you bring to the subjects we'll be talking about tonight.
Yeah, I'm Michael Ray. I teach at the University of Notre Dame. And I also teach philosophy of religion and some other stuff. I'm a Christian. Professor Myers said that religious pluralism is at least in part characterized by, first an effort to find creative insights from the various religious traditions of the world, but also to reject what seems inconsistent with human flourishing. You might think of Christianity as a way of life that is oriented around a particular story about what human flourishing consists in. So I guess among the what I would consider the fundamental truths of Christianity are, first of all, that the world has been created by a personal God who created human beings for the sake of having a relationship with God. But the second of all, human beings are sinful and broken, and that this sinfulness and brokenness is in some way an obstacle to our relationship with God. And so we're in a kind of predicament. And according to the Christian story, the way out of the predicament is just this. God became incarnate in Jesus of Nazareth, lived a perfect life, suffered and died on a cross, rose from the dead and ascended into heaven. And somehow all of this activity on the part of Jesus contributes to our sin no longer being an obstacle to having a relationship with God, and also, in fact, to the restoration, ultimate restoration of all of creation to a perfect state. And so being a Christian, I think, is living your life in light of and in response to these fundamental truths. You know, and there are other doctrines that go into Christianity too, but I think this is the salient core of it. Human suffering is part of the story. It's built into the story. According to Christianity, it's it is one of the consequences of human sin. You know, the topic that we're talking about tonight, the problem of evil, is, I think it's one of the most important questions that serious Christians can reflect on. I mean, human beings live lives that are soaked in suffering, and it's altogether natural to wonder how a loving God could allow that to happen. You know, if God loves us, why would God allow us to suffer in these sorts of ways? So I think it's hard to be a Christian and to understand Christianity without having this question occur to you and without wondering about it. And so that's what we're here to talk about.
All right. So I'm going to pose three questions to each of my conversation partners. One question about suffering that comes from natural causes, and then another question that comes from about suffering that comes from choices, decisions, actions that human beings engage in, and then finally we want to talk a bit about the prospects for finding meaning or hope in the world of suffering. So let's start with natural suffering. This is something that we're all quite familiar with. In fact, just a couple weeks ago, we had a massive landslide on the west side in Washington that killed a whole bunch of people. So this would be suffering that doesn't necessarily involve any human agency, but nonetheless causes an awful lot of suffering. Things like landslides, earthquakes, natural disasters of various kinds, various illnesses that people acquire, and so on and so forth. And so, Dr. Myers, I'll start with you. What do you have to say about the claim that's made by some people that the sheer quantity of suffering that human beings experience is evidence that there cannot be a loving God who created us?
Okay. The question came to me in terms of suffering not resulting from intentional human action, and that's sometimes put shorthand as natural evil. So I think that some suffering may lead to a greater good. For example, pain receptors in the fingertips may give one a painful sensation, but they also will allow one to withdraw from a situation where one could possibly be badly burned. So if you're numb in your fingers, you're not going to feel immediate pain, but the pain that you feel could be very useful for saving the rest of your body or your limb. However, there does seem to be some kinds of suffering that don't have a point. We talked, yesterday at WSU, and Professor Ray and I had a little bit of disagreement, I think, down the line on this point. But I recognize that some suffering could be called pointless. It's what John Hick has called dysteleological suffering. That's teleology is the goal or end, the study of the goal or end, and dys means not having one. So dysteleological suffering would be suffering that at least from our perspective doesn't seem to really have any kind of point to it. So then as that works into the problem of evil, one would have to ask, is it possible for there for a loving and powerful God to permit dysteleological suffering or pointless suffering? And I think the question really boils down to a kind of logical question of whether or not God would have a morally sufficient reason for allowing instances of suffering. And a number of philosophers, including Christian philosophers, have shown pretty clearly that it's possible that there could be a logical argument that could be given for that. But I believe that at the very least, even if it's logically possible for there to exist a God and natural evil in the world, that at the very least we need to contend with God over that issue. That's what the Jews did in the Hebrew scripture, or what Christians call the Old Testament. In the book of Job, for example, Job contends with God and asks really the question, hey, what's the deal with that? And a modern Jewish writer like Harold Bloom in his book, Jesus and Yahweh, also contends with God over the fact of great natural evil. So I think that while it's possible for there logically to be an all-good, all-powerful, and all-knowing God and evil to exist, I think that it's the duty of a theist to contend with God on that issue.
Okay, and Dr. Ray, I'd like to ask you the same question. How would you respond to the claim made by some that the sheer quantity of natural suffering in the world eliminates the possibility that we're created by an all-powerful, loving God?
So here's a case of natural suffering that seems, I guess you can call this natural suffering that seems worth reflecting on. I think it was the 17th century, might have been the 18th, but I think it was the 17th, there was an earthquake in Lisbon, Portugal. It registered something like 9 on the, it would have been what would register something like 9 on our Richter scale. It happened on a Sunday morning when basically everybody was in church. The churches collapsed. A whole bunch of people died in the church services. But a bunch of people escaped. They ran down to Lisbon is a port city. They ran down to the beach, and they were running down to the beach partly to escape the fire that had started as a result of the earthquake. So, you know, here's this earthquake occurring during church, collapsing the buildings, a fire starts, everybody runs down to the beach, and about something like 20, 30 minutes after the earthquake, as everybody's going down to the beach, in comes a tsunami and just wipes out tons more people. This bit of natural suffering rocked the intellectual world in Europe. Voltaire's Candide was written, I think, partly in response to this. And a lot of people have thought about it. So what do you do with something like this? I think the first thing to notice is there are a couple of things that you might do. Just by way of analogy, suppose a friend of yours does something really, really, really hurtful. One thing you might do is you might just react, right? You might not really care. Right? You might suspect that they were justified in doing it, but you might not care. You might just be hurt. And if people try to explain to you why your friend might have done that, you might not even want to hear it. You might just be angry, and you might all you might want to do is express that anger. This, I think, is the kind of response that Professor Meyer was calling contending with God. And I think that's one response to natural suffering that often looks like but isn't really an intellectual response. It looks like an intellectual response because the people having it are asking questions like, how could God do this sort of thing, right? To which it's tempting to offer answers, but that's not really what they're after. Just like when your friend has hurt you, you might say, how could they do that sort of thing? But you don't really want to know, you just want to be angry about it, right? Interestingly, I think the Bible validates that kind of response. In the book of Job, you know, Job suffers a great deal. And at the end of the suffering, God comes in and says, brace yourself like a man. I will question you. You will answer me. And then there's various interpretations about what goes on after that. Some people say that God sort of flexes his muscles and says, stop asking questions. The interpretation I like, though, is one that says, no, that's not what God's doing. What God does, and you can read and see for yourself if you think this is what's going on. What God does is God shows Job who God is, and God shows Job God's care for creation. And on that interpretation, what happens at the end of Job is Job says, sort of like, you know, if your friend were to appear before you after hurting you and after you've calmed down, you might just look at your friend and say, yeah, I know you love me. And you might not need the explanation. And this interpretation says that's what happens in the book of Job. But, I mean, it looks to me like the Bible validates that kind of contending with God. The book of Lamentations is all contending with God. It begins with no hope. A little bit of hope shows up in the middle, and then it's squashed, and it ends with no hope, and it's just left there. You know, it's an interesting exercise to read that book and then say at the end of it, as we would in my church if it were read out, this is the word of the Lord, thanks be to God, when all it is a complaint against God. But I think God validates this kind of contending. So that's one thing that you might do in response to this. But the other thing you might do is you might say, I really want to know why my friend did this thing. I want to know whether they could be justified in doing it. And I want to speculate about the reasons they might have. And if I can't find a good reason, I think I might want to end that friendship, right? And your prospects for conducting that kind of inquiry reasonably depend a lot on your friend, a lot on what your friend is like, and a lot on the relationship between your intellect and personality and character and your friend's intellect and personality and character. And most importantly, it depends a whole lot on your ability to see the kinds of goods that your friend might see, to have access to the kinds of reasons your friend might have for doing the sorts of things that your friend has done. And it depends a lot on your ability to kind of creatively put yourself in your friend's position. I think that's what it takes to successfully execute that sort of question with respect to natural suffering in the world, when we're seriously wanting to know what might have justified God in permitting something like the Lisbon earthquake. Our prospects for success depend a lot on our ability to have access to the kinds of reasons a perfectly good, omniscient being might have for permitting something like that. And to see the kinds of values that a being like that might have, and to creatively, imaginatively put ourselves in God's shoes, so to speak. And to someone trying to execute that project, what I want to say is, what in the world do you think you're doing? You know, we're working with 3-pound pieces of meat that are not a whole lot better than monkey brains. What on earth could make us think that we'd have any idea at all what sort of purpose a divine being might have for permitting something like the Lisbon earthquake? Now again, it's not that I think this is an emotionally satisfying response to the question, why might God permit the Lisbon earthquake? It's an answer to someone who is seriously asking, with the thought of ending or never beginning a friendship with God. They are seriously asking, look, is it possible that this sort of evil have a point? And the thought is, if I can't find a point, I'm going to take that as evidence that there's no God who might have had a justifying reason for permitting that. And to that person, what I want to say is, even if there were a point, you wouldn't be in a position to detect it. And so your inability to spot a point that's not a reason to think that God doesn't exist. Again, this is no comfort. Right now, we're talking about a purely sort of intellectual response to evil, one that says, I'm not going to believe in God unless I can see this to be the sort of evil that has a point. And again, I think that we are not in a position to be able to tell whether it would have a point. And so we cannot count the fact that we can't detect a point as a reason not to believe in God.
Okay, thank you. So another form of suffering is the kind that comes from things that people do to other people, right? So as I was driving over here, I was listening to the radio, and they were talking about how it's been 20 years since the genocide in Rwanda. And certainly the Holocaust during World War II features prominently in many people's minds when they think about horrible things that people have done to one another. And so that's the next question we want to consider. And so I will reverse the order. Dr. Ray, I'll allow you to answer first. I'd like to hear your thoughts on what the capacity for human evil, how that fits with the Christian account of who human beings are and what we're capable of. And then also, as a sort of a corollary question, what would you make of the complaint that some people would make that God's failure to intervene in such a case of extreme suffering counts against God's existence or power or love?
So the first part of the question is how the human capacity for evil sort of fits into the Christian story about God and human beings. And here I think the answer is just God created us with a certain kind of freedom to choose. And God also endowed us with a lot of interesting and extraordinary, at least in relation to the rest of nature, interesting and extraordinary abilities. And when you put these two things together, creatures that can act freely and creatures that are smart and creative and good at problem solving and able to sort of think about clever ways of accomplishing their goals and so on, you get the capacity for great good and you get the capacity for great evil. And when you give them a lot of time to work out all manner of different ways to wield power over one another and oppress one another and cause one another grief for the sake of revenge or pleasure or whatever else human suffering is brought about to serve, you can just expect a lot of evil to show up. And so the question is, does the fact that God created a world with creatures like this somehow count against the existence of God? And here I want to say much the same thing that I said in response to the earlier question. It all depends on whether you think there could be a morally sufficient reason for doing that. A lot of people have thought that just the mere fact of a world with interesting creatures like us who are able freely to enter into or reject a relationship with their creator, that by itself is sufficient to justify the permission of all manner of different kinds of evils. And I think there's something to that line of thought, but we still want to know why God doesn't at least lessen it a little bit. Did you really have to suffer through, say, the last hour of the last stomach virus that you had? Would your freedom have been undermined? I guess that's not moral evil. Did you really have to be cut off one more time on the freeway, on that long drive that you took or something like that? Would anybody's freedom have really been undermined if God had somehow prevented that? I don't know. In the end, it all comes down to the question whether you think God could have a morally sufficient reason for permitting these kinds of things, whether somehow all of the evils that go into our lives could figure into a grand and good story, one where at the end of it you'd say, yeah, it was, even though those were particularly bad things that happened, overall, the story is a good one. And here I want to say the fact that God's omnipotent, omniscient, and perfectly good, that's a reason to think that this is at least possible. And so this stuff counts as evidence against the existence of God if I have some reason to think, no, in fact, this or that evil doesn't and in fact couldn't serve some greater good. It doesn't and in fact couldn't have a point. And again, I think that we're not in the position to be able to tell that sort of thing. Our cognitive faculties are far too limited. And so again, we're not in a position to say that we really have evidence against the existence of God here. We're in a position to hurt and to be angry and to be upset. But rationally speaking, we're not in a position to say that we have counter evidence against the hypothesis that the world is governed by an all-powerful, perfectly good, all-knowing being.
Okay, and then Dr. Myers, as a religious pluralist, what do you make of the fact that human beings are capable of extreme evil? And as part of answering that question, you might also speak to how you understand the distinction between good and evil, and also whether you think a loving God might intervene in events such as the Holocaust.
Okay. So I appreciate very much Professor Ray's reading of the book of Job. The fact that God reveals God's self to Job as a kind of solution to Job's problems in life, I think is a dramatic ending to the book and really describes well what happens in the book. It's a lot like Krishna's revealing of himself to Arjuna in the Hindu classic, the Bhagavad Gita, and there are probably some other parallels that could be drawn there as well. There's still a little bit of dissatisfaction I have with the end of the book of Job, though, and I wanted to state that. Remember that Job has his possessions restored, and some of those possessions are his children and his family, and that strikes me that someone unmistakably male and ancient wrote that book, because nowadays we really don't think of our children as our possessions, and because you get new children and your old ones are gone doesn't make up for the loss of the old ones. So there's something that's still kind of dissatisfying to me about the book of Job, although I think it's a great book and full of wisdom. Okay, so I want to clarify my position. My position is that the sort of the amount of evil in the world, I don't think that it precludes the existence of God, but I think that it might be necessary to downgrade God's job description a little bit. And I want to use the Holocaust as an example for that. I would also like to draw a distinction between having a morally sufficient reason and knowing it. Professor Ray, I think, makes a good point that we might not be able to know what God's reasoning would be in allowing evil. But I think that this point still has to be made that God would have to have one, whether we know it or not. In regard to the Holocaust, or more properly called the Shoah, from 1933 or so to 1945, I think that that event shows in an immediate and powerful way that some suffering is disteleological and irredeemable. And I think that the way we contest that is not by trying to get into the mind of God or by asking ourselves from our perspective what the Shoah meant, but to actually ask the people, you know, that survived that experience and that have written about it. People like Primo Levi, who was an Italian Jewish scientist who went into the concentration camps in 1944 and survived 18 months and then became a writer after the war. So there's two different perspectives on the Shoah, I think, that are necessary to look at. One is the perspective of the victims. Now, the victims' perspective has to be, you know, sort of the bottom line perspective on this. The people that were killed in the Holocaust did not deserve their fate. Anything that, you know, sort of smacks of they had it coming, or, you know, some sort of reason that God saw that we didn't see, that we don't see, you know, is distasteful and unethical, or at least a couple of words that we could apply to that. So there's that. The other thing is the perspective of the criminals who perpetrated the Holocaust. So they used systematic science and technology in order to put to death an entire people. There were maybe 14 million Jewish people in the world, and they succeeded in putting to death 6 million of them. They went through every closet and bathroom and cellar in Europe in order to root out every single Jewish person that they could find in order to put them to death. So this was a great crime. And it was a great crime of not just one person, the head of the Third Reich, but a number of people that aided him in his crime. So it really seems pretty clear to me that we can make the judgment that God would have no morally sufficient reason for allowing the Holocaust to occur. To me, anything else is going to defame the Jewish people, take away their basic goodness, and it just won't stand. The Holocaust included, I mean, you've probably read, seen movies, et cetera, about the Holocaust, but, you know, there were lots and lots of babies and children and pregnant women, the elderly, the handicapped, as well as regular folks, you know, that were put to death during this terrible period. And so I think that what we have to take from that is we have to sort of downgrade God's job description. In other words, it's not really an emotive thing where I'm just saying I'm angry, or I'm asking the question, why did God allow this? I'm asking God. I'm not asking you or me or anybody else. I'm asking God, why did you allow this? And that is really, I think, a form of a prayer. That's the way I understand Harold Bloom's book, Jesus and Yahweh. Now, Bloom is Jewish. He's an English professor at Yale. And he has a daughter who suffers from some disabilities. And then he also has close ties to the Holocaust. And so because of these two evils that he has suffered in his life, he puts it this way, he thinks that God has gone into some sort of self-imposed exile. Another way he puts it is that God has not come through with his part of the covenant. Now, I'm not sure I want to go that far and say that God is in some sort of self-imposed exile, although it seems like a plausible thing. But I think that if you combine these thoughts about the Holocaust with liberation theology, and the way theologians in the Christian religion have looked at oppression, black liberation theology, womanist liberation theology, Latino and Latina, and even disability theology, then what happens is that I think we move to a new conception of God, a conception in which God doesn't necessarily have to have these old three O's, as they were, as they're sometimes called, omnipotence, omniscience, and omnibenevolence. And rather, a God who, you know, we might be conceiving power, ultimate power, in the wrong way. I mean, ultimate power might not be what we thought ultimate power was. Just like, it, you know, we can't have a square circle. I knew a couple of priests at Gonzaga. One was from the Department of Theology and one was from the Department of Philosophy. And the theologian said to the philosopher, Harry, do you know what the first thing you're going to see when you get to heaven is? And Harry said, no, what, Steve? And Steve said, a square circle. You know, and so, you know, the theologian thought that was amusing. The philosopher thought it didn't make any sense. The point of the little joke is that there might be a way we're thinking about the traditional attributes of God in ways that it's impossible for God actually to have those kinds of attributes. So that's what I mean by a sort of downgrading of God's job description. Like I was just finishing a book up in class today called The Disabled God. You should read it. It's easy to remember the title, The Disabled God.
So as you can perhaps tell, we do have some prepared questions that we're working from, but I also have permission to go off the script a little bit. I think I'd like to do that right now. I'm wondering, in light of what you've said, Dr. Myers, and also in light of what you said, Dr. Ray, are there reasons to trust God as we experience him? Maybe I should give him more context. So I thought of that initially, Dr. Ray, in the context of you saying that we're not necessarily in a good position to know what reasons God might have for allowing great evil in the world. And but of course, you still affirm belief in God. And so someone might ask, well, why? Given all the seemingly strong evidence going against it. And I wonder if maybe, Dr. Myers, if maybe an interpretation of what you said is perhaps to suggest that perhaps we can't trust God. I don't know. Either of you want to take a stab at that?
Do you want to go or do you want me to?
Go ahead, I'll hold a second.
Okay. I'm going to start, if this is permitted, by saying just a couple words in response to what was just said, because that figures into the question about can we trust God. There are two things I want to say, somewhat related. First, ask yourself what you would think you should say if someone you love a lot came to you. You know, they've gone through some horrendous suffering. Think of whatever your conception is of extremely, extremely bad, potentially irredeemable suffering. Imagine your friend has gone through that, and they come to you and they say, fully seriously, my life has been wrecked. This is completely irredeemable. No good can be brought out of it. It serves no point. This has made my life not worth living. Because that's what it would be for it to be irredeemable. It's to make the life just not worth living. Would you validate that? Do you think you should validate that? Not necessarily in the moment. I mean, when people are suffering through this sort of thing, often what you gotta do is you just gotta sit down with them and, you know, suffer with them. But long term, as they try to struggle through life with this, would you persistently validate that and say, yes, it's irredeemable? I couldn't. This gets to the second thing I'd want to say. What would be my evidence? What would be my evidence that it's absolutely irredeemable? And how could I validate that sort of claim for someone I love? unless I had overwhelmingly good evidence that their suffering is irredeemable. And in fact, the reality is I don't feel like we have our own powers of imagination as we can't imagine what would redeem it, and that's about as far as we get with evidence that the suffering is irredeemable. But I mean, look, we're considering the hypothesis that there's a God who knows vastly more than we know, and who understands goodness vastly better than we do, and who understands the connection between evils and sufferings and what it would take to redeem suffering and things like that vastly better than we do. And in that sort of context, what could be our evidence that it's irredeemable? So now the question, can we trust God? I don't know. You might not like what I have to say about this. I think we can trust God. So you might like that. But, you know, it depends on what you think we can trust God for. Can you trust God never to let you suffer? Of course not. People suffer all the time. Can you trust God to protect you and your loved ones from very, very bad things? Of course not. That happens all the time. If you think that those sorts of things only happen to people who have sinful defects in their faith, and if you furthermore think that there are people who don't have sinful defects in their faith who somehow escape great suffering as a result of not having those defects, I think you're hopelessly misguided. The fact is, we, you know, those of us who have faith, we all have defective faith, even the best of us. And the fact is, even the best of us suffer greatly and suffer all manner of different things. So can you trust God not to allow these things to happen? I think no, of course not. God never told us that these things wouldn't happen to us. God never asked us, really, to blithely trust that we would never suffer. Can you trust that the outcome of all of this, whatever you've gone through, whatever you will go through, can you trust that it's good? Can you trust that at the end of your life, you will look back on the story that's your life and on the grand narrative that it's woven into and say, yeah, that's good? Can you look back on, can you trust that you might even look back on your suffering and think, on the one hand, that was awful to go through, but on the other hand, given the way the whole narrative worked out, I actually wouldn't change it. I actually think that you can. And I actually say this as someone who has suffered things that if I were to describe them to you, you would say, yeah, that's real suffering. That's not like hangnails and things like that. That's real suffering. And I look back on a lot of this suffering, and I think it was bad to go through. But the overall narrative is something good, and I'd actually go through it again. And I've heard people say that sort of thing about suffering that before hearing them say that, I would have thought is life-wrecking and is absolutely awful and involves lots and lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of pain and abuse and torture and all manner. I mean, people say this about all kinds of suffering. So can you trust God that that's the perspective you might have and that in the end it will all be for the good? Yeah, I totally think that you can, and I think that we have no evidence, really, that we can't.
Okay, nice question, whether or not God is trustworthy. I would add the language of whether God is worthy of worship. I like to kind of think of it that way. And I'm not going to say that I think that the answer to that is no. I'm hoping that the answer to both those is yes, that God is trustworthy and that God is worthy of worship. If God wasn't worthy of worship, then God wouldn't be God, because worthy of worship is reserved for God. But I would make a distinction about this irredeemable business. I never would want to hold that a life that has great suffering in it, where the suffering ends, and then there's a chance to live on, is irredeemable. I think that that will always be a redeemable life. The thing that's irredeemable is the event of the murders, for example, in the Holocaust. That's just an example. There are other examples. When the babies, the children, the women, the elderly, and the men were put to get to death in an immediate, rapid fashion. And not only were they put to death, of course, but they were dehumanized beforehand, so that they were the life in the camps was a life such that everything that was done or said was meant to make the people who were the inmates in the camp feel as if they were less than human. They were fed not enough food, for example, to live. They had the runs, diarrhea or dysentery, and yet, according to the regimen, they were only allowed to go to the toilet at a certain time of day. They were not allowed to wash their clothing, it was like the camp was one big bathroom. And it was planned that way. It was planned that way in order to dehumanize the people that lived there and died there. And then, of course, death was the ultimate thing. And there were the selection process, you know, where you would line up, all of you, you know, and you would walk down the aisle, and there would be somebody sitting at the front there that would say left or right. And one direction meant life for a few more weeks or days or hours, and the other direction meant the day after tomorrow, you will be killed. And of course, it's not just right away. You get to contemplate the fact that you were selected for death for a couple of days. So I don't think it's that the life that has great suffering is irredeemable. I think it is the event of the murders that event is irredeemable. And that's the event where we want to contend with God.
Okay, I'm going to pose one more question to our conversation partners before we invite you all to ask questions of them as well. And I'd like to end by inviting both of you to think about the prospect for hope or meaning in a world full of suffering. So Dr. Myers, I'll start with you. What do you think the prospects are for finding hope or meaning given the suffering that we see in the world?
Well, Dr. Ray made a suggestion last night that I thought was quite full of merit for thinking about suffering as I understood it. And he suggested that if we take a story of a life full of suffering and we put that together with other stories, then that can be a very great thing. And that can give us hope and meaning. So I think that's a great approach. I don't think that it's possible to find meaning in the suffering itself. I think that we have to hope to find meaning in our response to the suffering. And I think that that's something that we sort of forget as philosophers when we're talking about the problem of evil, and as human beings when we're living in community with one another. Because this is the lesson of the Bible, this is the lesson of other sacred texts of the world, and that is, you know, how do we respond to suffering? How do we take care of those who are suffering or those who are in need? The liberation theologians put it in terms, how do we express an option for the poor? The Hebrew scriptures and the New Testament as well put it in terms of, how do we take care of the poor, the widowed, and the orphan? I think that that's what we're supposed to be doing, is we're supposed to be caring for those who suffer, and we're supposed to try to lessen one another's suffering. That's sort of the bottom line, I think, for talking about hope and meaning in regard to suffering.
Dr. Ray, how would you respond to that question?
The British theologian N.T. Wright wrote a book on the problem of evil in which he said, the real problem of evil is just that evil's bad. As a philosopher, I don't totally like this, and he sort of dismissed the philosophical problem of evil, but the larger point that he was making, I think, was a nice one. He said, you know, look, the problem of evil is that the problem is just that evil's bad, and the question we ought to be asking is, what's God doing about it? What's God doing about it? And the answer, of course, is God sent Jesus. And somehow the life and suffering and death and resurrection of Jesus are all supposed to contribute to God's fixing the suffering in the world. You ask, well, you know, how exactly does that work? And the answer is, in part, I don't totally know. You know, again, I'm just working with something a little bit better than a monkey brain. But at least I feel like I could see this much. You know, we're told in the Bible that the church is the body of Christ on earth. And so somehow the life of the church, where the church is, you know, the sum total of Christian believers throughout time and history, somehow the church figures into this story about what God is doing about evil and suffering. And I think the church figures into the story. The church and the afterlife and the possibility of forgiveness, all bought through what Jesus did, somehow all of this figures into the story about how we can find hope and meaning in our suffering. And as Dr. Myers kind of alluded to, I sort of think of it like this. You know, our lives are a bunch of individual stories woven together into a much larger story. You know, what you want to do is ask yourself whether you can see your life, and I would say particularly your life lived out in response to the gospel of Jesus, whether you could see that in the end being a good narrative, even if it's soaked in suffering, and whether you can see the total narrative into which all of our lives are woven as being a good narrative, even though that too is soaked in suffering. And the Christian story, the Christian offer of hope, is that in the end, that grand narrative into which all our lives are woven will be not just a good one, but a great one, all the sufferings included. And our judgment at the end, when we look at that, will be that the suffering has been redeemed and defeated, and that somehow the work of Christ was at the middle of it all. And that we will look even at our own individual lives, whatever suffering they've contained, and we will judge those to have been lives worth living. And you know, if you ask, well, but will we also judge that we have found meaning in the suffering itself? I say, we won't judge that the suffering itself was a great thing. So if that's what you mean by finding meaning in the suffering, then yeah, no, of course not. But if what you mean by finding meaning in the suffering is, will you judge that that the responses to it and the way in which it figured into the narrative and, you know, sort of everything else that actually just would have been completely different had you not gone through the suffering, will you judge that all of that is good and that it was worth going for? The Christian story encourages us to say, yeah, that's what we would judge, because God's good and God loves us. And so, it, you know, I guess for me, the question of whether I can find hope and meaning in all of this comes down to the question of whether I can believe the Christian story and its implications about these narratives and all that. And I do.
All right. Thank you, moderator. Thank you, Dr. Meyer and Dr. Ray. Good talk. My question, I would like both of you to touch on, if you could. Supposing a omnipotent, all-loving, all-good God, what type of world would we expect? And let me elaborate a little bit. So God creates a world with gravity. He gives us nociceptors so we can feel pain. Would we expect God to suspend the laws of gravity every time we trip and fall? And would you expect him to teleport everybody away that was about to get murdered, or would you expect him to follow laws? And if he does that mean he's not good?
You might not totally like this answer, but I guess
sure,
I think a friend of mine has built a case for the sort of a new interesting version of the problem of evil around just this question. I suppose you have two aliens, one of whom is a naturalist and one of whom is a theist, and they get to sort of witness the beginnings of a world that's going to, you know, evolve in ways that our world has evolved and so on. And he says, you know, what would each of these people expect and how would they update their beliefs as they start to see the world increasing in its amount of pain and suffering and so on and so forth. And my response to this friend of mine and my response to you is, what makes you think that we could reasonably expect anything? Right? It's sort of like, taking little kids into, a large factory that's making rocket ships or something like that. And you let them watch for 5 minutes and then say, okay, explain in detail what you would expect these people to do next. And the little kids, if they're smart, they'll just say, you know, they'll laugh. Like, I don't know. I mean, if they had the vocabulary for it, they'd say, we can't even begin to have an inkling of what's even starting to happen in this room, much less judge what ought to be expected by people who have a real clue about where it's all going and what it's supposed to be doing. The flippant answer to the question is, well, you'd expect a world like this because this is what we got. The real answer is, if I were actually confronted with this sort of question at the beginning of a world unfolding, I'd say I have no clue what to expect. I would think if I was reasonable, I would insist that I can't possibly have a clue what to expect.
So would you say that that his failure to suspend natural order means he's not good?
I would not say that.
Okay.
Because I don't, I have no idea what, actually it's not even true that I have no idea what goods it contributes to. I mean, you know, I look out at the world and I see a world with a lot of pain and suffering, but it's a good world. And we tell lots of good stories. You can buy some at the bookstore that include lots of pain and suffering. And I see lots of goodness in the world. That by itself is at least a little bit of evidence that, yeah, the failure to suspend the laws of gravity and stuff doesn't automatically count against God's goodness. And then add the fact that I also have no idea what greater goods God might be trying to accomplish. Yeah, I wouldn't say it counts against God's goodness.
Okay. Rather than starting with the conception of an all-good, all-knowing, and all-powerful God, and then trying to reason from that what sort of world there would be under that kind of God's creation and leadership, it seems like a more valuable exercise to me to take the world that we have and then think about what kind of a God could be possible given the world that we have. And I think my approach is really sort of the modern or postmodern approach to it. And the other question is more of the medieval or classical approach. So it's not that I think newer is better, but I think that the modern or postmodern approach to the question does us more good in our present day. So the other side seems so highly speculative to me. So I would rather look at the world that we have now and have the courage to mess around a little bit, theologically speaking, with God's attributes.
Thank you.
Okay, why don't we switch over here? Go ahead.
So my question is, when you're talking about dysteleological suffering, it seemed that the logical implication of what you were saying is that so the most evil suffering is death, or as to put it in the words of the Bible, the last enemy is death. So would you say that in order to sort of visibly answer the question of why is there suffering, or to redeem suffering, would it be necessary to redeem death or to overcome death? And in that case, what do you make of Christianity's claim that Christ did in fact overcome death already?
Is that for me?
Yes.
Sorry. Okay. Dr. Ray can also answer, but I do not think that death in itself is an irredeemable evil. I think it's really our fate, each and every one of us. And since it's a pretty natural thing, I think it would be probably best not to think of it as an evil. What I think is evil is a bad death, like the death that suffered, you know, under the conditions that aren't necessary, like the deaths in the Holocaust. Now, bring me around again to the Christian part of the story there.
Yes. And so, if death is sort of the, or at least a bad death is the ultimate evil, what do you make of Christianity's claim to have overcome death, to have redeemed death?
Well, I guess that's asking me about my view of the afterlife, and I'm very hopeful actually about an afterlife. I don't think, though, that it might be too great to over-specify it. So I'm not sure I can buy into some real specific sorts of claims or pictures that are made about the afterlife. But it kind of seems to me, and this is just a totally personal reaction, that to say that there is no afterlife might be just kind of it seems to me to lack a little bit of imagination. There could be other worlds, couldn't there? I mean, even the string physicists say that there are 11 dimensions and we're only aware of four of them. So I don't see why there couldn't be an afterlife. And I know that there are many people that differ with me on that. In fact, there are some Christians I know that are not very optimistic on the afterlife that I know, but I mean, Christianity is not just one thing, right? I mean, you can be a Christian and have various kinds of views in opposition to other Christians. But I tend to think positively that there, and hope that there is some kind of an afterlife.
And if I may ask a quick clarifying question, how would you distinguish, the death of, say, a martyr, someone who's dying, like, a cruel death, but a death with an obvious sense of meaning, a death that doesn't cause them moral suffering. How is that distinguished from a death which is cruel or even isn't cruel but is not filled with moral meaning?
Well, a soldier that puts his body or her body on top of a hand grenade in order to save the lives of the other members of the squad is that kind of a great martyr's death, I think. I mean, there's moral value and nobility in that. What they were doing to those people in the Holocaust is the opposite.
I'll just respond to this really quickly. I guess I take you to be offering a kind of argument that goes something like this. If there's any irredeemable suffering at all, any suffering or evil that can't be overcome, it would be death. But look, the Christian story says death has been overcome, therefore it all can be overcome or redeemed or something like that. And I think that's a nice point. In a certain way, I guess I kind of think that's at least part of the reason why Jesus rose from the dead, as opposed to doing any number of other interesting dramatic things that might have been done, like jumping down off the cross, or, you know, appearing as a big hologram in the sky, or, you know, in any of a whole number of special effects that could have been accomplished. I think it was to illustrate this point. Death isn't necessarily the ultimate evil. I don't think it's certainly not the only evil. Overcoming death isn't the only thing that has to be done to fix the world. But wow, like, if you can get past that, okay, I'll believe that you could get past just about anything. I think that's a nice point.
Why don't we swing over here?
Hi, thank you both for coming out. Now, if we assume that all suffering, natural or otherwise, is in fact dysteleological, as you described earlier, that is to say there is no ultimate meaning or purpose to it, would you say that we being human beings as we are, could give meaning to it? And if so, how might we go about that? And it's directed at both of you.
Okay, so I don't hold that all suffering is dysteleological, only some. But I'm open to the idea that human beings might be able to invest what appears to be dysteleological suffering with meaning, although I'm not sure you can do that for another person. See, that's the big rub, you know, with the Jewish experience in the Holocaust, is we try to make all these excuses for those people. You know, they're the only ones that can speak for themselves. So if they want to say, yes, we can make some meaning out of this, then I affirm that.
I guess I think, too, human beings can make meaning out of certain kinds of sufferings. Not to be flippant, but, you know, fraternity hazing rituals kind of come to mind, right? Here's a case where usually relatively light suffering is imposed upon some people, and they undergo it voluntarily, and they make it meaningful in certain ways. A whole lot of rituals work like this. So yeah, we can invest some of our sufferings with meanings, but there are, most of us can actually probably think of examples from our own lives. But if we can't, then we surely have friends or neighbors or people in history we can turn to. I think that there are sufferings that outstrip our capacity for investing suffering with meaning. There are sufferings that are so big and so dramatic, sufferings like the ones Professor Meyer described, where if these things happen to you, and if it's really true that they don't fit into any larger narrative that's a good narrative, and if it's really true that there's no God who is redeeming them, then there's nothing you can do. There's nothing you or any human being can do to make it meaningful. That was just pure tragedy. That's a kind of depressing outlook. I think particularly if you don't believe in a God. But I also think that's the truth.
Okay, why don't we switch over here?
All right. Thank you guys for talking today. It was great. For Ray, you made the claim, God loves us, right? Is that, I heard that sentence tonight. Yeah. So, in response to, we can't understand, you know, the absurdity of suffering. That's beyond human comprehension. If we cannot know the theological explanation of suffering, what gives us the knowledge complex to have a theological explanation of love? Like, how do we know God loves us if we can't know why he doesn't hate us, if that in layman's terms? Does that make some sense?
Yeah. Yeah, so I guess I take the question to be, if you don't know exactly the reasons for which God is allowing you to suffer, how do you know God loves you?
Yeah.
Is that about right? Um, You know, when I was little, I sang this song, Jesus Loves Me, This I Know, For the Bible Tells Me So. I mean, the more sophisticated version of that is we have authoritative testimony from God's word as written down by human beings that God does love us. And the fact is, you don't need to know why God allows you to suffer, or at least not exactly why, in order to reasonably believe that God loves you. What you need is to have the stable belief that somehow it's for the good. You know, my kids know that I love them, and I make them suffer on all manner of occasions, right? I tell them they have to stop watching their movie, I don't let them have cookies, I send them to timeouts. And, you know, often, at the timeouts, I explain why they have to have those, but, you know, a whole lot of the rest, I don't really explain it. My daughter wants to know, as she's running out into the middle of the street, why I'm saying stop running out into the middle of the street. And my answer is, it doesn't matter why, you just come back here, right? And I can explain it later. But they don't need to know the details of why. What they need to have is something like a reasonable belief that it's all for the good. And sometimes they're just not even capable of understanding why. In our own case, actually, I think most of us who are Christians, we do, on some level, understand why. We think that our sufferings somehow contribute to making the world a better place or to making us better off, or hopefully both. More detail actually wouldn't really make the suffering hurt any less, and it wouldn't satisfy us anymore. But I think that initial bit of detail is all we really need to reasonably believe that God loves us.
And I guess then for both of you, we don't need to know the details. Are you okay? Why are you okay? If you would contest against that, with that lack of not knowing details of, you know, the absurdity of God, you know.
Just to be clear, are you asking me?
I'm throwing that out to both of you, your thoughts on that.
Do you want me to go?
Yeah, you can go ahead, because I don't think I ever said that we don't need to know the details. I would really like to know the details.
Yeah.
I was basically thinking he's not okay with it. I'm the one who's okay with it. Why am I okay with it? I feel like I'm really small and not very bright in relation to God. I also feel like, though I try hard, I'm not really all that good in relation to God. I mean, I try, but I'm selfish. All too often, my views about what's good are remarkably self-serving, right? Even when I try for them not to be. They're remarkably skewed in the direction of human goods. They're remarkably skewed in the direction of what makes me feel okay. There's a lot of self-interest that informs my moral views, even though I try really, really hard to be other-regarding and all that sort of thing. So I think whatever goods are served by my suffering, my bad suffering, the suffering that would be hardest for me to see as redeemed, I imagine I'm likely to be blind to those. I also imagine that many of them are likely to be such that if God were to sit down for a week and try to explain it to me, I still wouldn't get it because it's just so complicated. I suspect the answer to why did I have to suffer on this occasion will involve an extremely long causal explanation about how this fits into the whole history of the world and into my life in particular, starting from birth and ending with my death and invoking all manner of goods that aren't even in view for me, some of which I may not even think are good because I'm imperfect. And so it would just be too much. And that's the sufferings in my life, you know, and I with other people, I have access to so little of their total story and their relationship to God that it's, you know, the situation for figuring out how sufferings might fit into your life or into the lives of people in distant cultures from, you know, in distant countries from other cultures, that's hopeless, I think. So that's why I'm okay with not knowing the details. I think it's totally beyond me.
Okay, let's shift over to here.
I have a question for Dr. Myers. Is that your name right? Okay. It's a really big if question. If you or any other individual already acknowledges the existence of an omnipotent and omniscient God who created the universe, how can anybody, this isn't just to you, anybody who holds that view provide a reason to an authoritative point to contend with God based on the morality that he has already placed into existence himself?
Well, I think that the sacred text tradition gives us the model, you know, in all the traditions, the Jewish tradition, if there's something that goes clear against our intuition, then the commentators are going to throw that out. They're going to reinterpret. They're going to question God, essentially. I mean, that's kind of what it boils down to. The Christian monks in the medieval period, Muslim commentators, Buddhists and Hindus, they don't put their brains at the door when they walk into the holy place. They engage the text, the tradition of the text, and they're willing to overthrow those interpretations or those parts of the text that go clean against their ethical intuitions. They might be wrong, and they might have to, it's a little bit like the way the Supreme Court works. They might be wrong, they might have to go back and revise again. They might have to revise back to the position that they had before. But I think that the example of the sacred text is that people do this. I mean, they even wrestle, physically wrestle with God. They have debates with him, you know, in the Garden of Eden. You know, what tree were you eating? You know, where's your brother? You know, nowadays we think of God as an abstract thing, you know, with these abstract properties of omnipotence, omniscience, and omnibenevolence. But it might be helpful to move beyond those sort of abstract qualities to a little bit more living kind of thing.
Okay. Wait, real quick, I'm sorry.
We do have a whole bunch of other people who'd like to ask a question,
okay.
So maybe we should move on. Sorry, though. Let's go over here now.
Thank you both for coming. This question is for Dr. Myers. You had made the claim that a lot of suffering is dysteleological, and
some.
And I know that you seem to know the scripture, at least you know the book of Job, and as a Christian, it's a big book and you have to dig, but the Bible explains, it doesn't leave it undisclosed, it explains why all suffering is teleological, all moral evil, natural evil. You have to dig, but it's there. And I'm wondering if, I'm just curious if you know those answers that the Bible gives for how all suffering is teleological, do you either not know what it says, or do you know what it says, but you just don't buy it?
Well, last night, Professor Ray was instructing me on the book of Job, actually, in a quite nice manner, which I kind of acknowledged tonight when I talked about his reading of that. But I disagree really heartily with you. The Bible is clear in mining all the suffering of the world and explaining how it's teleological. I just don't see that. Well, now, I know my understanding of the Bible is really finite, but from the reading I've done in it and about it, that seems to me to be a pretty bold claim to say that the Bible clearly shows that all suffering has a purpose.
Well, I'm just here to ask questions, not give answers, but I'll be, and I don't mean particular suffering for particular individuals. General principles that the Bible gives for why, natural evil befalls a city, or just for example, in James it says, consider it pure joy whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance.
I was just reading, if you don't mind me cutting you off there,
sure.
A bit. I was just reading in that book I was saying, The Disabled God, the author of that, Nancy Easland, was really contending with that precise passage.
Right.
She really thought that was kind of a lot of bunk.
Okay.
Can I comment on this?
Sure can.
I guess I also want to say I don't agree that the Bible clearly explains, even at the level of general principles, how all suffering contributes to greater goods. I think the Bible gives us some clue as to how some suffering might contribute sometimes to greater goods. And I would say this about the passage about evil befalling a city, for example. Maybe on some occasions there's that story to have been told. I certainly wouldn't want to say there's a kind of general principle of, I wouldn't say this about Lisbon, whenever the earthquake occurred. I wouldn't say that, well, that's why suffering befell Lisbon. It was there were people at the time who said that, but I think that is not something that we can or should say on the basis of Scripture. I think that the Bible asserts, I know that the Bible asserts, and you know it does too, that all things work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to God's purpose. And I think that implies that all suffering contributes to a greater good in some sense, or that all suffering is redeemable. But I really would not say that you could dig through Scripture and find how all suffering, again, even at the level of general principles, contributes to greater goods.
We can talk, yeah.
Okay, I'm gonna shift over here. I think this will be the last question, but for those of you standing in line, please know that when we wrap up tonight, you're more than welcome to join Dr. Ray and Dr. Myers up here at the front. So I'll give you the last question, and then we'll begin to wrap up the night.
This is a question for both of you. I'm curious why individual choice was not brought up in response to protecting us from suffering and pain. Is there a response or reason to this not being part of your arguments or statements?
No, it was just an oversight. You make a very nice point. Individual choice is central, to the existence of human suffering, and especially moral suffering, but even natural suffering, right? We shouldn't build our houses right next to a forest, So I grant the point.
I'm all for cabins in the forest. I think the reason it doesn't enter so much into discussions like this is the really hard cases or ones where the suffering occurs. And there are plenty of cases like this where the suffering isn't the result of individual choices. You know, I mean, think of the suffering of abused children, for example, or again, you know, think of the suffering of a whole lot of people in the Holocaust, or, you know, you could sort of go on and on about how people are, you know, the term that gets used in the literature on the problem of evil is victimization, right? Where people are made to suffer, not as a result of their own choices, but they're just made victims of often really horrendous evils. And those are the cases where it's really incredible to say, well, still they're suffering for their sins, or still they're suffering because God's trying to teach them a lesson, you know, or something like that. And so that's why it's those sufferings that get focused on an individual's choice sort of after a certain point drops out of the discussion. Is it's just the hard cases are the ones where that's not involved, or the hardest cases anyways are the ones where that's not involved.
Thank you.
So I'd like to give each of you an opportunity to offer a closing thought. And it can be an observation on our conversation tonight or anything else that you feel like you'd like to say that hasn't been said in the course of our conversation.
Okay. Well, one thing that came into my mind was that I think a really nice strategy for transforming suffering is to create art. I think a lot of the world's art, music, painting, sculpture, all forms of art, have been a result of people's dealing with and transforming suffering. So in terms of our last question of finding hope and meaning in suffering, it seems to me that making music or doing a quilt or making a beautiful garden or anything like that, it just sort of normal human creative activities are probably the best plan. At least that's what I'd like to offer.
I guess I'd just like to come back to something I said more toward the beginning of this, and that's I think it's really important to recognize whether you're a Christian who's just thinking about the problem of evil, or whether you are either a Christian or someone who's not, and you are in the throes of kind of existentially grappling with how a loving God could possibly permit this or that to have happened to you or your friends. In terms of figuring out how you ought to think in response to the problem of evil, I think it's really important to keep in mind that there really are two sides to this. One is just the kind of, you know, what do we do existentially with this? We, you know, where do we find comfort? This, you know, evil hurts. And we're inclined to react with mental words that sound like arguments, things like, you know, God can't possibly love me, from which you can infer, well, okay, then God's not perfectly loving, therefore, if God, you know, since God exists only, if God's perfectly loving, God doesn't exist, and, you know, there you went, right? But often those mental words aren't, you're not reasoning about it, or a person's not reasoning about it, it's a pained reaction. But then there's the careful, considered, let's see if there's anything that could really justify this. So let's try to figure out whether we really ought to abandon belief in God or never even consider belief in God. And I think, you know, the two problems need to get dealt with, but both in your own head and when you deal with others. The two problems need to get dealt with in very different ways. People in pain who are saying, God doesn't love me, don't need to hear an explanation that tells them, oh yeah, God loves you, and here's probably why God's permitting your suffering and things like that. They need comfort, they need to be loved in return. And if you are having that reaction, that's odds are better than not, that's what you need, whether you see it or not. People who are calmly, coolly reasoning about this sort of thing, that's where a lot of the considerations that have come out tonight start to become useful. because then you can sit down. I think if you sit down and reason it through and pay the right kind of attention to your own limitations, and again, I know we have disagreement on this, but I think if you pay the right kind of attention to your own limitations, you will see you don't actually have evidence that the evils you've encountered are pointless, and so you don't have evidence that God doesn't exist. And again, that's not comfort. That's something that can help you hang on to faith later on in the pained moments, but that's not comfort. It's reasoning. It has a completely different place. And I think it's just important to keep those two things separate.
For more information about the Veritas Forum, including additional recordings and a calendar of upcoming events, please visit our website at veritas.org.